Hi, I'm Vicky Garcia, and I am an out boss now for almost 20 years.
Hello, out bosses. Rhodes Perry here, and welcome to this week's episode of The Out Entrepreneur, a weekly podcast where I get to interview today's most inspiring LGBTQ bosses crushing it in business. And on this week's episode, I am super, super excited to be introducing you all to Vicky Garcia. So Vicky, welcome to the show. I'm really excited that you're here. And you're calling from sunny Florida, right?
And it actually is sunny today, which we are known for sometimes being rainy. But in Florida, you get rain and sun all on the same day. So
I love it. I love it. So yes, that's my home state. That's where I grew up. So it's nice to have you on the show and all the way across the country. Over here, we don't quite yet have the sun, but we will live vicariously through you. So for those folks who aren't familiar with Vicky and her work, she is among the most respected women in travel, serving as the COO and co-owner of Cruise Planner. Vicky was appointed godmother of Viking Cruises European Longship and named Woman of the Year by the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Her contagious spirit and commitment to charity work helped CP Cares Cruise Planners nonprofit organization raise and donate more than $2 million to local, national, and international charities. She is also a passionate advocate for LGBTQ plus travel, serving as board member for the International LGBTQ Travel Association. So Vicky, welcome to the show. I'm excited because we have not had many folks in the travel industry on the show. So why don't you kick us off and tell us a little bit more about kind of what the travel industry is like in 2020 and really what makes your business unique?
Sure. Thanks for that great introduction, Rhodes. It made me kind of blush a little bit. That doesn't happen very often.
Yeah.
The travel industry, it's funny you haven't had anybody from the industry because it's hospitality, which is probably heavily, you know, filled in with LGBTQ. So it's pretty interesting. I've met most of the people that I know in the community through the travel industry. So we need to get more people on your show from the industry.
Yeah.
But I'll gladly start it off.
Thank you.
Yeah. So I am... been in the industry almost 30 years now, which sounds like crazy, but I did start when I was about truly 20 years old, maybe. Yeah. And how I got into it was because I love to travel. So it truly was a passion for travel, and I left my family's insurance and accounting business because that, for obvious reasons, it sounds boring, and it was, and skipped over after going on my first cruise and went to apply at two cruise lines and was in the travel industry ever since back in 1987.
Wow. Wow. So you've seen the industry change, especially, I mean, 1987, maybe some people had email, maybe some people had connection to, I don't know, like that's pre-AOL internet, but like, you know, the travel industry before kind of the boom of the internet and then after. And so I'd be interested in kind of like hearing your take on how you've seen that evolve. And also like, if you could walk us through as well, like you started in 1987 and it sounds like you were working for maybe someone else. When did you break out and form your own business in the travel industry?
So I formed my own business, not in the travel industry, about 1998-ish, just for a couple of years. I was able to buy someone's business, and okay. I was very green. Mm-hmm. I was able to, you know, grow the numbers and build the business up till I was able to sell it for really good money and take 3 months off before I went to go back into the travel industry. So it was pretty interesting. I come from an entrepreneurial family. So my parents owned their own businesses. My brother's a dentist who runs his own business. My sister owned her own insurance agency. So it's what we were born to do. You know, my dad made us grow up doing our own taxes and making sure we had money put in an IRA, even as kids before we even knew what it meant.
Yeah.
So really we're taught the basic stuff about running your finances and having a business mind and making decisions that kind of you didn't realize you were learning at the time. It wasn't a class, but you're learning by being kind of on the job and surrounded by it.
That's really, I mean, to be surrounded in a family, you know, with other folks that just have that fire in the belly, you know, of running a business is, I feel a little envious. I did not kind of grow up in that environment. So it was one of the reasons why I started the show is to have some additional mentorship. And it's great to hear that you had that kind of stitched into your family from the beginning. When you were working for, like, so pre-1998, when you were working for other folks, what was that experience like then? You know, having been so surrounded by entrepreneurs for most of your life, was that a big cultural shift when, you know, you're no longer kind of in that mindset of being the artist of your own business? You're kind of, you know, in some ways, see, you're following along with someone else's vision for the business that they've created. What was that like for you?
Sure. It's interesting. So I worked for my family business for years, and truly I hated it because I wanted to get away from the family when I went to work, not keep with the strict Cuban families. If you hear of Cuban families, they're Hispanics in general, very strict on their kids or whatever. So it was my parents' way of keeping all the kids close together. Mm-hmm. So I didn't know there was any other way to work other than working for a family business. It was what I thought people did. And then I found a way out when I, again, 19, 20 years old, and I went, I'm going to go apply at this company because I know someone there. And I'm pretty adventurous and just applied without even telling them. And all of a sudden I get a call. My mom's like, hey, you've got Royal Caribbean Cruise Line on the phone for you. And she's like, who is that? And where are they calling you? I'm like, well, I'll tell you later. Let me get the call. And I had a phone interview and then had a follow-up interview. And I told her, and she's like, what are you crazy? Your dad's going to lose his mind if you're going to leave the company. But then he realized he can get pretty discounted cruises. And my dad being an accountant is very cheap. So that worked out really well. I was at Royal Caribbean for almost 11 years. And honestly, was it culture shock? A little bit, but I learned so much. So I learned the basics from my parents in the entrepreneurial side of it. But working for an organization like Royal Caribbean helped me learn so much more. That taught me management skills. Mm-hmm. And this is back when the company was a lot smaller than it is today. But still, if you're going to grow with the company, they make you go through management courses and all the basics for HR and sexual harassment and, you know, how to deal with difficult situations and all that stuff. I got to learn, and I failed to tell you this, I'm actually a high school dropout and never went to college. So I considered that job my college.
Yeah, yeah. That totally makes a lot of sense what you're describing, where it's, you know, when you are working for someone else, regardless how you get the job, right? Like you get this job, and as you grow yourself kind of professionally, the company's growing, and it's great to hear that you had that professional development along the way where you learned how to kind of interact with like HR processes and dealing with people and all of the people that, you know, outside of your family dynamic of how you learn to communicate in the family and then the family business. That's so, it's a really different experience when you're working for such a large company like Royal Caribbean, which I don't know how many thousands of employees are probably working there, but it's much bigger than a family business, right? So it's really...
Then it was very...
Yeah.
But I grew through the ranks of that company. And again, without having, you know, a high school, I mean, I have GED, but that's it. But I think it was part of that entrepreneurial work hard that it was just inbred in me. It's like, you give it your all. You run, even though you're working for somebody else, you run it as if you own it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I was promoted many times throughout those 10 years. I pretty much was constantly being promoted, which, because I just never gave up. I always wanted something more. And oftentimes it wasn't something that I was applying for. It was people recruiting me to a different department to lead it or whatnot.
Right, right. I like that, you know, just like that constant commitment for improvement, and that you were rewarded for that, which is really, really good to hear. So you got the urge, you left that company, you were there for 11 years. At some point in the late 90s, you acquire a business. Like what was that shift for you to kind of go to move away from well, one, the family business, two, Royal Caribbean, and then jump into the world of entrepreneurship, which you're very familiar with, but buying a company, that's definitely like a big, big commitment. So what was going on for you at that point, and why did you take the leap in 1998?
Yeah, it was interesting. I mean, towards the end of my tenure at Royal Caribbean, I had been heavily managing call centers, which can get stressful. It could burn you out a little bit.
Yeah.
I still have some of my finest, my best friends in the world still work there, and I'm friends with them and we keep in touch and whatnot. But I had an opportunity. A friend of mine's father was looking to retire. He owned a small business. It was interesting business that I knew nothing about. It was a bingo novelty company. Huh. But I looked at their financials and I said, well, if I can afford it, I'll finance part of it. And owned it for about 3 or 4 years and was able to, again, sell it because I think we tripled the sales in it back then. So we're able to, you know, again, super small business, but we're able to rework it. We moved the offices and the warehouses. So we did a lot in those few years to really make it successful. And it was just two of us running this company that was, you know, $6 million in sales.
That's amazing. So it was, you were able to triple the sales and you sell it. And then is that the point when you then created your travel company, or kind of like fill in the blanks of from when you sold that particular company and how you ended up where you're at today?
Yeah, a Norwegian cruise line, which I'm sure you've heard of also, yeah. they recruited me to run their reservation center. And I went down there, we talked about it, whatever, and I took that job on, and it was right before 9/11, about a year and a half before 9/11. So I was there for a couple of years. We did some great things. We were probably the first, one of the first call centers to have home-based or remote call center agents. So in a call center of about 400 team members that I had, we had about 85 that were remote, working from home. So we had to work with new technologies and phone companies and whatever to make that happen. But it really helped us be a lot more efficient, save money on office space, obviously. So that was a good tenure. 9/11 happens, and it got really tough. I was like, and there was some technology changes and whatever happened, and it was just time for me to move on. I had recruiters calling me. And then, so I didn't start Cruise Planners. My business partner did. She's the founder, Michelle Fee. She's the company is celebrating 26 years here. I've been with the company now 16 years, but if I really add, I'm gonna back up a little bit. 2 years before that, my partner at the time and I bought a Cruise Planners franchise. And that's what we are as a company. Cruise Planners is a franchise company. So therefore, we run the corporate office here in Coral Springs, but we have over 2,500 franchisees all over the country, mainly working from home or really from wherever they want. They can work from their mobile device, and they're pretty much travel agents, travel advisors. So as a franchisee, I then came to work as an employee here at the home office, at the headquarter office. And then shortly thereafter, I grew through management. I started as a director of groups and went on to EVP, sales and marketing. And then about 7 or 8 years ago, I was afforded the opportunity to buy into the company. So the co-founder and myself and another partner actually got together and we bought the remaining shares of the company, of Cruise Planners. So we own it 100%.
Okay. This is really, really interesting. So again, I feel like you're among some of the first people that at least I've spoken to on the show where you've got a franchise type model. And so I guess for folks that aren't as familiar with what that means, could you kind of explain it to the audience and what might be some of the benefits of being a part of a franchise or being kind of the company that is doing the recognizing other franchisees or just being a franchisee, a part of a larger kind of family of companies? Like, help us understand that.
Sure. So as a franchisee, or as a franchisor, we have proven systems. You know, we build our own technology. We have our own marketing programs. We offer our own support team and business development coaches. So when you're buying a cruise planner franchise, you're buying all of that. If you remember the old days, that Verizon commercial where, you know, that whole group of people is right behind you. That's what we are. We don't sell travel from this headquarter office. We are 100% to support our franchisees. Think of a franchise as a Nothing But Cakes or Subway Subs. Those are franchisees, or Burger King or McDonald's. Yeah. So they buy it. They are not Bob's Burgers. They are Burger King. Same thing with us. Someone buys a Cruise Planner franchise, they now have the power of the brand of Cruise Planners, whether they live in an apartment building in a little town, because they've got all the tools and the market to support their growth, and they now have a very viable home-based business. They don't need experience in the travel industry. We teach them everything, so training comes with it. Gives them the flexibility, again, to work from anywhere they want. I mentioned that we have proven success, and then we're also affiliated with American Express. So it's Cruise Planners and American Express travel franchise. So our representative.
Yeah.
So, and the cool thing about being in the travel industry is you can travel for sometimes free or very, very low cost. Like I'm just packing this weekend. I leave next Friday for Budapest to board a river cruise and sail the Danube River for a week.
That's awesome. Take me with you. No, I'm like, that's yeah. I mean, there's lots of perks, right? That comes along with like being a part of the travel industry. There's other industries too that just like that's a part of obviously what lights you up, right? Like you like traveling, you get to do that as a part of everyday business, which is great.
Yeah, and the franchise, that it all comes with that. So it's a proven system. It's almost a business in a box. I hate using that term because I think everyone overuses it. But you really do get everything with it. Like the minute you join, we create the business cards. We create your marketing. I mean, the system just runs by itself almost. And then the person is actually, the franchise owner is actually talking to the clients and I always say shaking hands and kissing babies, although these days you may not want to do too much of that.
Yeah, I know. I know. Well, I have a question about that, but I'm going to save that. That I wanted to circle back when you were talking about that you were able to buy into the company and you're now a co-owner of Cruise Partners. So what might be some things that, you know, for listeners who are like, oh, you know, I'm thinking about doing something like that, what kind of advice would you give folks before you enter? Like, how did you, I guess, let me take a step back. How did you evaluate, like, this would be a good investment for me to buy into this particular company? And aside from, you know, the financials, you know, that kind of health, what about, like, kind of co-ownership when you're looking at the other owner or owners, like values, you know, how do values show up for you that you know that your values are in alignment with the folks who own the company? Like, how did that come into play? And just like in thinking about some of our listeners, what advice might you give around buying stock or buying some kind of ownership of a company that already exists?
Yep. I mean, you have to have a basis of a relationship and understand that you do have similar values, right? You don't want someone who's totally opposed to what you believe in. And that's what I had with Michelle at the time, who was my boss. I didn't think twice about joining forces with her. I mean, we tease because every post on Facebook that we do, even business-wise, if she gets an award, I always said congrats to my BFF and, you know, business partner and partner in crime and whatever, because we get along that good. Now, yeah. To the flip side of that, that doesn't always work out that way. People that are friends, they go too fast into business together. And that's, I think, a cautionary thing for your listeners is be careful that you don't do it because you're just pals. Yeah. You know, Michelle and I had a business relationship first, and we respect each other. But we, at this point, she knows everything about my family, you know, how bad my nephew's behaving and everything else. So we just know about each other's, you know, I go to her daughter's wedding or her son's wedding. We're just that close. But we had to get there on a business level first. Mm-hmm. So you got to respect each other on the business side first.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's really valuable advice, and thank you for that. And you had that advantage, you know, you were working there, so you had a sense of what the company was like, you know, as someone who is more of in an employee role, right? And then you had this opportunity, which is sounds really ideal.
And and I knew the business. I grew up in the travel business, so it was kind of for me a no-brainer. Other than to buy into the company, I mean, I had to hawk everything because it was an opportunity to buy this big company, which was not my experience before. Mm-hmm. And I kept wondering what my dad and my sister would have said because they both had since passed, and they're probably going, "You're crazy." Yeah. To get this big into it, but I knew the company because I worked here, so I knew the potential to be successful was there. But it was definitely outside of my comfort zone. Other than I knew it was a no-brainer because I knew the company really well. I wasn't going out and buying a net new business that I didn't know anything about.
Yeah, yeah. So talk to me a little bit about, you know, you're talking about technology and how things have changed and how you all have your own systems within Cruise Planners. How has the, you know, since you started in 1987 in this field and where it is today, how has the internet kind of disrupted it, and how does a company like yours take advantage of, you know, kind of communicating the value that you still have in the world of travel?
So it's funny, I forgot to answer that earlier when you asked about when I started in 87. Yeah, it was, you know, dial-up internet back then, and I mean, one of the departments had a telex machine, and you're probably too young to know what that is. Then they,
What is that? Sorry, I'm like telex. I'm 40, so just for full disclosure, I'm kind of, I might know what it is, but I don't know. Is it a fax machine or?
So fax machines were even better technology. A telex was like this little machine that people would just type into. It would use a phone, mm-hmm. but it would come out almost like a calculator tape. It was the weirdest thing ever. Even for me, I was like, what is this thing? So, I mean, I was there when we rolled out Microsoft Word.
Okay. Yeah.
So mm-hmm. I am dating myself. So it's creepy to even think about it. And AOL, yes, was that dial-up connection. And I thought it was the coolest thing having AOL.
Yeah, same.
And now a shrieking sound. I use it as a joke often. And it's like, oh, God, that sound was awful.
Yeah, yep.
And you know, fast forward to now, it's, you know, we try to challenge the status quo. We look at what are other companies do? Number one, I'm a gadget girl. Like, I love technology, even though I'm a little bit of the older. I'm not a boomer yet. But I love gadgets. I always have to buy the newest phone when it comes out the first day. I mean, my only rule is that I won't wait in line for it, but I want it the first day.
Yeah.
So I'm always looking at new innovations and what other industries are doing. I don't look at what competitors in our space are doing. I really don't care. Many of them try to copy us in what we do. And we're just always 50 feet ahead going, what's the car industry doing? Like, what's a luxury car company doing? What does their marketing look like? Or what does some other cool company look like? I even look sometimes at companies like Target, as much as that's not a luxury product, but their marketing is spot on. Like, your TV comes on a Target commercial, and you know it's Target before they even show you their name or their dog. So I think our entire team, we challenge them to look for innovation and what new ideas we can do to take us outside the box. We're constantly innovating, and that's kind of what our space is in and what we like to do, which keeps our franchisees open. It keeps their business fresh. It keeps them competitive. Even though they're working their business sometimes from their mobile phones, from their bedroom on the desk, they look like they are a big agency because they've got the power of a big national brand behind them and American Express.
Yeah. That makes a lot of sense. So I'm wondering, as you're thinking about innovation and, you know, these next few months, the next year, the future holds for your own business, like what right now, when you wake up every day, is like lighting a fire under you, like that it just really, really excites you, makes your heart sing?
So, well, the time of year that you're asking that, or the time of day that we're asking that, with today's current environment, a different situation than you would have asked me 2 months.
Yeah.
But travel evolves. And look, even though this COVID-19 thing is going on right now and it's awful for our industry, we're still resilient. Our industry is resilient. It'll pass. We just got to see how long it'll take to pass, but it's going to pass. It's not stopping me or us from traveling. Most people that we talk to, they're like, it's not stopping me. Or is it causing a frenzy to some consumers out there? Absolutely. Is it affecting our business this year? Sure. But we've been really prudent business owners. We don't spend frivolously. We make sure that we're prepared to handle a downturn. And that's important in any business, is to have a plan. God forbid something happens. You know, we're down here in hurricane world, so we've been used to that. That stuff's going to happen. But how do you plan for that? And you never have the perfect plan, but it's to make sure that you have, you know, a nest egg to be able to ride through some of this stuff and make some adjustments along the way. But that those are things that for entrepreneurs, they need to think of. What's going to happen if there is something that affects their business for a lengthy period of time? I truly believe this thing will be over end of April, May. Like it'll be behind us. But you know, there's no crystal ball. It's a new string. So
yeah. I'm really glad that you mentioned that. And I'm wondering, you know, I mean, obviously we're talking very specifically about COVID-19, Wuhan flu, cough. You know, I mean, there's lots of different names for it. I'm wondering, like in general, you know, like when you're talking about, for business owners having a plan, you know, in the event that there's some kind of market correction, a downturn, whatever you want to call it, like what are some essential elements outside of this very specific virus that we're talking about that you would recommend, you know, outside of like cash flow, you know, and having like a nest egg, like you said, what are some other elements that you consider in your own business to prepare for these kind of moments?
Yeah, I mean, I think for us, we need to look at manpower. Are we properly staffed? Do we have open positions that we should delay hiring right now because we think this thing's going to end in 6 weeks? So those are some decisions you have to sit in a room and go through it. Mm-hmm. So that's a big one, is what are you going to do if this happens to you? And that's one of the ones, is do you have too many people working for you, or do you not have enough, or do you not have the right people? Is it an opportunity to clean house sometimes? I mean, it's sometimes what happens. I've seen some companies recently, and I'm like, I'm not surprised they let that person go because they've been talking about that person not being great.
Yeah.
So I think some people just wait till now to do that. Mm-hmm. But have a plan. You know, if your office has to close down for some reason, like we had it several years ago, we had to close down for 2 weeks because the building lost power after a hurricane. Mm. So it wasn't anything happened to the building, but we had to close.
Yeah.
And we didn't have that many laptops because it was probably like 7 or 8 years ago. So you have to be able to respond. So, you know, before hurricane season here, we have to have a hurricane plan and a backup plan. And depending on how big or small you are, for our agents with their small business, a franchise, you know, we offer support here to support them. So they might have a tornado in Texas, which just happened for some of them, and we'll take some of their calls for them, or we'll help them with certain situations. You know, again, it's a mobile business, so they can just pick up and go with their laptop on their phone. I had a guy, he's out in California, and for the California fires, he and his wife lost everything.
Yeah.
He ran out with his laptop, his and her phone, and they are now selling. They're one of our top agents, and they built that from nothing. Like they didn't have any experience in the industry. It was just his passion for travel. So it's thinking about how long can you last if you're not making money? That's something for someone to think about.
Yeah, if
it's not coming in, how long can the company survive, whether it's paying payroll or not, or, you know, whatever. But there's a lot of how mobile can the business be? Those are decisions you need to make too, is maybe you can just pick up and go somewhere where the hurricane, let's say, is not coming or whatever. But, you know, the stock market also is a big deal. Mm-hmm. So when the stock market happens or an election year, people tend to slow down their travel. So what we found, and it's the beautiful thing of the cruise industry, is if the rates are lowered by the cruise lines, people get over their fears really fast.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, I'm seeing that not so much in the crew side. You know, I do a lot of travel, you know, by plane, and I'm seeing a lot of those fares going down really, really low right now. So it's interesting, like, how great is your fear amongst, like, getting a really good deal and going somewhere great, you know?
I witnessed it firsthand, and unfortunately, it was after 9/11. I was at Norwegian, and I was running the call center, and the phones just stopped. Like, you could hear a pin drop in the whole call center of 400 people. Huh. And we were like, what are we going to do? And then they started moving the ships, instead of deploying out of Rome, moving them to close-in ports. So now much more ships leave out of New York, Houston, a bunch of Florida, you know, Fort Lauderdale and Miami and Port Canaveral, mm-hmm. L.A. So it moved it closer to home. And then it's funny, still wasn't working all the way. And man, those prices went down to $2.99 or $3.99, and the same people that were canceling and going crazy are like, "Oh no, I'll go for that."
Yeah.
So it was like there is a price for fear in some cases, and I think it happens to all of us.
Yeah, yeah, that's a really, really good way of putting that. Okay, I want to pivot a little bit. This is the Out Entrepreneur, and we haven't really talked about our awesome Rainbow Family community. And I wanted to ask you first if you wouldn't mind sharing, you know, some of your workplace experiences as it relates to being part of the LGBT community. And my first question for you, Vicky, is, you know, can you think of a time when you might have been working for another company outside of your own and probably your family's business as well, where it was hard for you to bring your whole self to work because you are part of the LGBT community? And if you can think of an example, I think that would be really helpful just for some of the folks who tune into the show and who are trying to negotiate how out they can be either in their work now or as they're thinking about getting started in their own businesses.
Yep. So, I mean, I wasn't out at my family's business, that's for sure. Yeah. And when I went to go work at Royal Caribbean, I think a few years later is when I finally even realized myself. I think I was in denial, if you will. Mm-hmm. So I used to do the same typical thing that a lot of us have done growing up. I used to lie about who I was dating and, you know, have this phantom boyfriend in Dallas that I would go visit every once in a while, which happened to be a girlfriend.
Yeah.
And that happened for a couple of years, but I never felt scared or whatever. I just didn't have the chutzpah to go out and say something about it. It was different times then, too. Mm-hmm. But over the years, I mean, you finally realize everyone's like, oh, we know you're gay. Like, what are you trying to hide? I thought it was so smart, and everyone kind of figured it out. And it was the coolest, warmest thing ever. I never really had to do a coming out, if you will. But I just, all of a sudden, I said, why am I hiding this? And everyone's so nice to me. And I am in the hospitality industry, like I said earlier, and it's a very, very LGBTQ welcoming industry. Mm-hmm. So it became a part of who I was, and I'm super authentic and very clear about it, transparent about it. And I feel like that's been part of my thing that makes people feel comfortable, is I've never hidden it. And I think people that are straight around me over the last, you know, 18, 20 years, whatever, are like, oh, you just make it so cool. I never even thought anything of it. Mm-hmm. Like my business partner, before I became a business partner, before she hired me, when I bought the franchise, my partner at the time, now my wife, we're asking her a bunch of business questions for our own little franchise. And I'm like, we want to focus on the LGBT community and whatever. And she was looking at me like, I didn't even know you were gay. Are you focusing on it because you want the business? Or are you girls really gay? And I'm like, yeah, that's why I'm asking about it. So I've never made it a thing to, you know, walk around with a rainbow shirt, although now I do just to support LGBT. But I never felt like I had to wear the pride stamp anywhere. But I just was myself. And I think that's what's not a differentiator, because I think everyone's a lot more comfortable these days, but that's where I don't have to cruise on an all gay charter. Mm-hmm. I don't have to go to a gay bar. I don't mind them.
Yeah.
I have friends, most of my friends are straight just because of, I don't know, that's just the way it's worked out. Mm-hmm. Neighbors and stuff. I just am my authentic self, and I make everyone feel comfortable. It doesn't matter whether you're LGBT or not. And that's where I don't have a great story, but I'm hoping that it is a great story.
It's a fabulous story because it's yours. And I think like what you're saying is so true for a lot of us, where it's our own stuff sometimes of, you know, like what you were talking about with your family. Well, my family doesn't know, so I'm not going to tell them. And I mean, we're kind of like making up some of the stories of kind of things we don't have control over, which is how other people view us in the world. And the kind of, you know, what I'm getting from you is that, you know, when you were ready to share your story, the people that you have relationships with now appreciated that authenticity. They appreciated that you were getting vulnerable to share an important part of who you are and feeling more connected, because you were able to kind of just kind of lower your guard down a little bit to say, you know, like, this is an important part of who I am, and you're an important, you know, business partner or person in my life. And so, you know, this is my partner, this is my wife. And I think that's really, you know, it's one of the things that's popped out on this show for folks when sharing, you know, being part of the LGBT community in the workplace environment, you know, that's helped people kind of be liked, known, and trusted more, right? Because they're able to be themselves. And obviously not everyone can do that for a variety of reasons, largely around safety or feeling insecure in their job and keeping their job. But in the moments when we can share that, it's really key. It's really important. And I'm wondering on that piece of, you know, you had mentioned the authenticity and kind of building deeper relationships, trusting relationships. Like, it sounds like that might be one of your superpowers when it comes to rainbow superpowers in the workplace. I'm wondering, you know, if you want to expand on that a little bit more, or if you see other advantages of being a part of the LGBT community as it relates to standing out at work, and in particular, standing out as a business owner.
Yeah, so I'll give you a little bit of a story, because you asked me that before. Was at our convention, we have an annual convention every year, and we kind of told our stories, the executive team. And one of the things, I thought it was old news, like, but I'm gay, because everyone knows that. Everyone knows my wife, Carol. Like, she gets more of a applause, I think, than I do when I mention she's in the audience or whatever, because everyone wants to meet Carol. Like, she's whatever. So, but I actually went out there very sincerely and just told my brief story about my strict parents and coming, like, just how I grew up, and that the fact that I came home on Monday, and I'm like, okay, I'm gay. And I actually played that Ellen clip when she announced that she was gay. Just was a little bit of a shock to the family when I finally did that. But to our network, there was about 700 people in the audience. That night we had a different event, and I had people come up to me saying, and they're from all over the country. So some of them are from the Bible Belt. They come up to me crying, just at thanking me for sharing the story. One actually came to me, she says, I didn't know what to do. My granddaughter, I take care of her. She's 8 years old, and she told me she's a boy now. She knows she's a boy. Like, she just came out super straight. And this is her granddaughter, because her daughter had passed away or something. Yeah. And I told her, look, I'm not a professional gay. I can't guide you on that situation. I'm here to help you. I'm here to hug you. I'm here to whatever. But it's funny, some people think because you're gay, you know the answers to every gay question. And that's kind of a major myth. But what we try to do here to support people here is we recently had our first diversity day, where we let people come and tell their stories too, internal, like, team members here. And I know I diverted from your question, so I apologize on that, Rhodes. I just lost my train of thought as I did that.
Oh my gosh, no, you're right on track. Yeah, it's this kind of like superpowers, and it sounds like sharing your story, you know, like that just by doing that, right? You were in front of 700 people, and it sounds like a lot of people came up to you after of like, you are that possibility model. You're, you know, you're super successful in business. You're married, you have a great partner, great wife, and you were just able to share your story and say, hey, you know, I'm a lesbian, I'm part of the LGBT community. And even, you know, as you described it, you said, you know, it's old news to you. That's, you know, it's the first time you're introducing yourself to a lot of people in the room you're just meeting. And, you know, I'm sure for folks in different parts of the country, you know, where there aren't even protections, you know, even today, you know, that's huge, you know, so that the... I think it's that visibility, you know, like what you said now, like you don't necessarily wave the flag for business, but you wear a rainbow shirt in support of, you know, LGBT equity, justice, right? And just by doing that, I mean, I think standing in your power and being who you are for younger people in particular, who are just trying to figure themselves out in the world, you know, that really, I think it saves lives, honestly. Yeah.
We did a cute thing. We actually got married legally in New York about 7 years ago. And before that, my team here kept saying, come on, let's do this. There's going to be when Florida approved gay marriage, February of 15, so I was married 13, there's going to be 100 couples, Love is Love event, and, you know, Lance Bass is going to be there. Well, I'm not doing this whole public event thing, and I'm just, that's a little too shy. Carol's, you know, a little bit older than I am. She's going to be like, going to want to kill me. But after we went through the excitement of our small wedding in New York and with our close friends and whatnot, to think a year later, I was like, oh, yeah, I'm doing that thing. Let's do it. Let's put this out there, because I have a following of people that if I can show them that I can get married and be happy and be safe, why not? And it was one of the most beautiful things ever, because it was 100 couples that were entered to do this, and Lance Bass and his partner Robert were there, and it was just such a cool thing to be able, not everyone was gay, with the mayor of whatever was there, and she renewed her vows with her husband, but in support of, right? So a lot of politicians were there, it got a lot of media coverage, and it was just, I figured I had to do something to help others, not just my close-knit 32 people at our, you know, very private wedding in New York City. So it was another way to try to get people around it. And again, we've had so many positive comments on it. I just reposted it yesterday because it came up in my memories. So it's how can we help, especially as leaders, to show that it's not just we're doing pride and we party a lot. It's how are we being responsible citizens and showing people that it's okay to be gay. Love is love. And I truly believe in that so loudly for anybody.
Yeah. I think that's an important question that for a lot of folks who tune into the show, being LGBT, being business owners, there's power and influence that comes with that. And how do we give back in really meaningful ways? And, you know, and just like something to mention too, like where that event was happening, I was reading up on your background before the interview, and, you know, I was really touched, like, you know, seeing that you got married in New York, and I think it was 2013, but then to come back to your home state, to come back to Florida, and as someone who grew up in Florida, you know, it's just like, that's huge to be able to get married to your wife, or your soon to be wife, well, your wife, like, but like legit in your home state, you know, in front of your family, in front of the people that are most important to you. That's huge. You know, I just want to, you know, thank you for sharing that with us, because it is really huge. And then just kind of thinking with the privilege of being able to do that and live the life that you're living and, you know, being super successful in business, like how do we give back big, you know, when great, you know, when we are abundant and receiving, you know, how then, you know, do we take that responsibility seriously to give back? And I'm wondering, like, in your business, you know, you are a franchisor, and you've got a lot of franchisees out there, a lot of people benefiting from what you all do. Where does the commitment to diversity, equity, and inclusion, where does that fit into your company? And how are you really looking out for folks who, you know, maybe in other workplace settings have felt different or have felt othered and really have not felt a strong sense of belonging because of, you know, some aspect of their identity or something that makes them feel different in kind of the world that we live in today?
You know, diversity and inclusion is part of our core values. We have, you know, our HR department is not an HR department. It's a people and culture department. Yeah. We work really hard on, and I make that department reports right to me. And we made that change recently because I felt, you know what, I can't have someone in between that. It's got to come from the top.
Yeah.
So that we are always focused on diversity and inclusion. I've served on the board for IGLTA, I think you mentioned at the beginning, which is the International Gay and Lesbian Travel Association. We were able to get the first gay couple to get married legally on board a ship, which was one of our employees here. And we got a lot of coverage for it. And, you know, we sponsored it. We gave them the PTO time to do it because we wanted to get the coverage on it. We just do a lot of events for LGBT. And the beauty of it is one of my most proudest accomplishments, really, is that I don't have to push that here.
Yeah.
Everyone has feels it in the culture. So oftentimes, if you saw the video of the Love is Love event, that team of people that were around me, it was people from here that says, can I go, can I go, can I go? And wait, we got to push you to the front of the line so you're walking right behind Lance Bass. And wait, I want to wear a rainbow thing for that day. Or I'm going to bring the flowers or whatever. It was not me saying, hey guys, we have to have this event and I got to show up and we got to get media coverage. It was all of them wanting to be a part of it.
Yeah.
When I was first going to get married in New York, it was my team here that says, you guys can't just go to the courthouse. You got to do a wedding and come on. And so that to me is the biggest accomplishment, is to get people that work on your team that truly believe and fight the fight and love the love. So I rarely ever have to ask anyone to do anything. And again, I think it's the challenge within us to be authentic about it. And now to me, it's not even a thought. To me, it's like, oh, I am who I am. Or, you know, Carol one day surprised me here and she walked around this office and everyone's like, oh my God, Carol's here. Cause we live kind of far from the office. So she rarely comes here.
Yeah.
So, but everyone embraces it. So that to me is a huge accomplishment that I know I have Bible Belt people and people that don't believe in it, but they believe in me and they love me and they reach out to, today's Carol's birthday. So today on Facebook, her Facebook is blowing up.
Yeah. Happy birthday, Carol.
And some of them don't even know her. Some do. Some know her by name or by my Facebook post or whatever, but they show the love. Like I've never had a hate comment ever.
Yeah. Yeah, that's huge. And and it goes down to your leadership, right? I really appreciate what you said about, you know, you have a people and culture department, a core value of Cruise Partners is diversity and inclusion, and there's no one in between who leads up the people and culture department and you. And that shows that, like, you have the commitment and you have that vision and you have the courage to share that with all of your franchisees, and they know it. Whether or not they personally believe or not, I mean, that's a core tenet to your company's culture, and that's huge. It's really, really huge, and it says a lot about your leadership, so thank you. I think that's really, really huge.
Thank you, Rosa. I'll make one correction. It's Cruise Planners.
Oh, sorry. Cruise Planners. Sorry. I'm thinking, we're talking about partners and wives, and I'm like, okay. Yeah. Cruise Planners.
Hi.
Yes. Man, I'm just looking at the time. I'm really enjoying this conversation. So a couple more questions for you. One, you know, when we're thinking about, you know, the younger LGBT folks, aspiring entrepreneurs, what might be one piece of advice that you would share, you know, as you kind of look back on your own journey of kind of guidance or, you know, something to consider as folks think about taking that first entrepreneurial leap?
You know, I would say don't try to reinvent the wheel. You know, don't try to think you're going to start a new donut company or whatever. I mean, unless you truly have some magical potion donut. I mean, that's why I think franchising is so successful, is that the systems are built for you. So if you were to go out and, let's say, try to start your own travel agency, I wouldn't suggest it. This is not a selfish plug, but by any means. I'm saying it truly as if it was my brother, my niece, or nephew, is don't try to start doing something that someone's doing it better or has been around for years. Not that it's always right, but if you find someone who's like a franchisor, and I'm not going to totally plug franchises here, but just to give you the difference, the system's already built. The technology is there. We have people that say, I'm going to build my own website. If you're a salesperson, you can't build a website. I mean, you can, but you're going to waste resources on that. Mm-hmm. So I would say look into, if you're looking at something, just check out franchises. I'm not saying just Cruise Planners, but check out franchises. But also, you know, have a business plan. Know that you're thinking through, you know, do you need people? Do you need manpower? Do you have to build something? Do you need to, you know, a trademark or a registered mark? Some of those things are super expensive. How mobile is your business? Is it web friendly? I just saw someone put an ad, and I won't say the name of it because it's a critical thing, but it's like, here, I make the best cakes and I'll deliver, but only has a phone number, no email, no website, no anything. And I'm like, how are they going to succeed? And they wasted money on an ad. Mm-hmm. I get if you're the guy in town who makes cakes and you just happen to have word of mouth, but you're paying for an ad that you didn't have the expertise to do. So I think looking at the whole business plan really can help you and see if it works. And then talk to an expert. You know, sometimes small business associations have experts you can talk to. Align yourself with other LGBT businesses so that you can get referrals from them and have mutual referrals. Join networking groups. Works really big for our franchisees. And that's pretty good. I mean, look at, obviously, yeah, you know, how you can market your business and go to market quickly.
Yeah, I love that. I mean, don't reinvent the wheel. Make sure you have a plan. And, you know, lean on the networks that you have. And if you don't have a network, there's lots of great kind of resources online, including this podcast, where you get connected to an entire network of people who've been there before. They've done it. So save yourself some time and save yourself some mistakes for the future, to kind of fail faster, to have that big innovation, that big breakthrough that you want. So this is super, super valuable. I really appreciate your time, Vicky. And I want to make sure that people know where to find you online. So where would you like our listeners to go just to learn a little bit more about you and everything that you're doing in business today?
Probably the best place to go is www.cruiseplannersfranchise.com. And there you can look at why would you want to join the number one travel franchise, why Cruise Planners in general, and you can meet the team. So you can find my bio and your whole executive team. So that if you're looking to buy a franchise for your own business to plan travel from home or from wherever you are, or if you want to buy some travel, we've got 2,500 franchisees there to help you plan your travel.
Nice. Yeah. I will definitely check that out myself for some fun vacations this year. So thank you so much for being on the show, and we will make sure we'll get all of that good stuff in our show notes. Again, Vicky, thank you. You're inspiring me for what you're doing in the world. For all of our listeners, remember, our show comes out every Tuesday morning. If you haven't had the opportunity to subscribe to the podcast, rate or review it, you know, you can find it on iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, wherever you're consuming the podcast, it's there, it's available, and I would love your feedback. So please consider texting OutBoss, all one word, to 33777, and you will have the opportunity to get connected to the show notes from today's conversation with Vicky, and you have the opportunity to share your feedback on what you like about the podcast and what you would love to see change for the future. So keep being your authentic selves 100% of the time, and we'll connect again next Tuesday.